It's my pleasure to be here in conversation with Ashwin Sanghi. And it's a special occasion because we are celebrating 10 years, the first decade of Ashwin as an author. Is that right?
Absolutely. The first book, The Rosabal Line, came out in 2008.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you can see how much they love that too. You know, now to start with, I have another reason for celebration to share with you, and that is that the fifth book, Keepers of the Kal Chakra, has been awarded the Popular Choice Award given by Arta Galata. So the award ceremony is tomorrow, and those of you who haven't read that book, you must read it. Now, so I think we could sort of applaud Ashwin for that as well. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks, Madhavi. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, now to jump into the matter straight. Now, Ashwin, your novels are, all your novels, all five in the Bharat series, are a blend of old and new. The ancient and the modern. Now, the ancient is, of course, the mythology and the history. And the modern is, of course, the science and the thriller aspect
yes.
of it. Now, you have said somewhere that earlier, I think you've said it several times, that mythology is lies we don't believe in, and history is lies that we believe in. What is science?
Okay. What I actually said was that I believe in myth far more than I believe in history.
All right.
Because history ultimately is a version of events. I think it was George Santena who said that history is a narration of events that never happened, written by people who were never there. So, I mean, in that sense, if you think about, let's say, 1857, we call it the Great Revolt of 1857, whereas the English students still hear about it as the Sepoy Mutiny of 1857. Same event, but written very, very differently. On the other hand, what C.S. Lewis says is that a myth is a lie that contains a truth. So in that sense, a myth, you're not worried about the actuality of those events. You're more concerned with the central kernel of truth. And that is fundamentally what is more exciting. The way I like to think about it is that many of our great figures in mythology were probably based on some historical figures or some great historical event. Think about this, that an epic like the Mahabharata started out with 25,000 verses of the Jaya, went on to 50,000 verses of the Bharata, and went on to 100,000 verses of the Mahabharata. It would never have morphed into this magnificent epic if some real events hadn't happened. Why would that epic continuously evolve? And that is the great bit about India in general. India has a wonderful way of being able to take all of our stories and present them in different ways, maintaining the central kernel of truth. So, I mean, you have 300 versions of a Ramayana. And, you know, so you have, let's say, a Tulsi Ramayana, which talks of Ram as God. You have a Valmiki Ramayana, which talks of Ram as a human being, an ordinary mortal. You have things like the Adbhut Ramayana and the Anand Ramayana, which talk about Sita manifesting as Durga in order to kill Ravan. You have the Lao Ramayana, which talks of Ram as a Bodhisattva. You have the Muslim Ramayana, which talks of Ram as a Sultan. So the point is that one truth does not negate another. And so that is where I feel that myth is a far more deeper understanding of the truth than history.
Yeah, well, that's very interesting. Now, the thing is that, okay, so myth tells us the truth and history tells us the facts.
Yes.
As put down by someone.
Of course.
What does science do?
So, I mean, I think to a very great extent what happens is that for all of us, the delicious question is what if? What if this were true? What if Ram existed? What if? And the point is that today's generation doesn't necessarily just want to know that as per the myth, Ram won the war in Lanka and got into a Pushpak Viman and traveled back to Ayodhya. How did that, what was that Pushpak Viman? How did it happen? I mean, I can tell you my growing up years, my skills in storytelling actually came from my grandfather. And Nanaji was a consummate liar also and a storyteller also. And I think the two go hand in hand, really. I mean, I had no qualification to write fiction. And people used to ask me, what is your qualification? And I would say, you know, my mother used to say that I was always a very good liar. And that is what I have continued doing even now. I tell lies. But having said that, during the time when I was growing up, my grandfather, I remember him telling me this story about a rishi that he met on the banks of the Ganges. And the rishi, they were sitting opposite one another. And this rishi, he told him, apni aankhein band karo. So Nanaji closed his eyes. And then this rishi about half a minute later said, ab apni aankhein kholo. And so Nanaji opened his eyes. But he could not find the rishi. He looked left, right, center, wherever. Aage, piche, as they were. And then there was a voice which said, Murkh, upar dekh. And he looked up. And this rishi was levitating somewhere there. And you know, I must tell you, Madhavi, that day I went back to my mother and I asked her, I said, what brand of weed does Nanaji smoke? Because, you know, this man has lost it, right? I mean, I was probably in my teens.
Yeah.
But today I'm willing to accept that it was possible. Just because I can't understand it doesn't make it less real.
Yeah.
And I think this is really the crux of what you've asked me, that those are the gaps which science is trying to fill. I remember this wonderful discussion we ended up having another conspiracy writer who I deeply admire, Dan Brown. When he was in Bombay, we had this wonderful conversation where he asked me the definition of God.
Hmm.
And I told him, I said, Dan, and I wrote it on a piece of paper.
Hmm.
I said, G is equal to infinity minus K. And by the way, we were by then about 5 drinks down each.
Yeah.
So it became all the more philosophical.
Yeah.
So G equal to infinity minus K.
Yeah.
So he said, what is this? I said, G is God, what we call God.
Hmm.
Infinity is the wider universe, the entire universe. And K is that part of the universe which we call human knowledge, which is the part of the universe that we have explained.
Hmm.
So what we have not explained is God.
Yeah.
What remains?
Yeah.
The Egyptians saw the sun rise in the east and set in the west.
Yes.
And they said, it's Ra. He goes across the skies in his chariot. And when he gets tired at the end of the day, then he goes to sleep and it becomes night.
Hmm.
Later on, Copernicus, Galileo, and everyone else told us it's a huge ball of fire and energy.
Hmm.
And suddenly, poor Ra lost his divinity because it was no longer unexplainable.
Yes, yes, yes.
So that is where science comes in.
Yeah, I think science is a bit of a bore. Let's, you know, it's much more interesting to listen to the stories. So, well, coming to your all 5 novels in your Bharat series are conspiracy thrillers. I think that's what they've been called. And definitely they bear all the hallmarks of a thriller. They are fast-paced. They are, you know, several plot lines moving together. There's that quest. Always, you know, it all starts with that. Then there is the chase and there is the sense of imminent danger, multiple settings and innumerable twists and turns. With all the other things that you bring into this mix, with so many moving parts, how do you create a single narrative thread?
whiskey helps.
That's a new...
But beyond that, I would say the biggest friend is actually a spreadsheet, an Excel spreadsheet. All my novels are initially plotted on Excel spreadsheets.
Okay.
That's, I guess, the Baniya in me, because that was one tool which I was very used to using in my previous avatar as a businessman. But it's sort of, there was a spillover. So now what I do is, take for example, the fourth book in the Bharat series, the Sialkot Saga. Now that story spans about 75 years, starting from 1947, going up to about 2010, 2012. So if you look at the original spreadsheet of this plot, you'll find that the first column of this spreadsheet talks about the year, 1947, 48, 49, every year, all the way up to 2010. The second two columns talk about the two main characters. There are two characters, Arbaaz and Arvind.
Yes.
So they, what were their ages in that particular year? Based on their ages, what would they have been doing at that time? Would they have been in school? Would they have dropped out of school? Would they have gone into business? Were they experiencing their first kiss or their first romance? Were they locked up in prison? What was happening to them? Then after that, what is the twist at the end of that particular year? What takes the book beyond? And finally, what was happening in India at that time? What was the backdrop? Culture, social, history, politics, what was going on in that year? And that is eventually the basis on which the Sialkot saga could be written. Otherwise, I would have lost track of all the threads.
Yes.
And that's pretty much what I do with each and every novel. I will spend anywhere between 6 and 9 months on the research. There is an old proverb which says that if you are going to tell a lie, then tell the lie as close to the truth as possible. Because it becomes that much more believable.
Yes.
So I know that I'm telling you a lie because that's my job as a fiction writer. But my job is to do the necessary research in order to make that lie very, very convincing. And that's what I do.
Well, I think you, I mean, you know, don't keep saying you're telling us a lie, because all your stories sort of, though they are incredible, you know, on based on incredible premises, they become very, by the time you are in chapter one, chapter two, chapter three, you are deep in them. So it sounds like the truth.
Someone asked me the other day, Madhavi, that what are the rules for writing a bestseller? So I'll just repeat it for the people who are here who are wannabe writers. Step one, your first paragraph should be like a pothole in Bombay or Bangalore. Sucks the reader in with very little chance of getting out. Second, that make sure that every chapter ends with a hook which propels the reader into the next chapter. It should not be an option to turn the page. The page must turn on its own. And finally, end the book with a sense of contentment, satisfaction for your reader, but more importantly, make sure that he or she looks out for your next book. Otherwise, how will you remain a bestseller? So I would say that those are the three golden rules, and probably that answers your question.
It does, completely. The hook actually lies in the last chapter. Yeah, that's the bait you're supposed to swallow. Now, you know, normally they say about thrillers that these are plot-driven, but I found one distinguishing feature about all your books, and that is characterization. You've done something very interesting with characterization, and by developing, firstly, multiple characters, parallels with parallel stories, and also with backstories.
Yeah.
So all your characters have backstories, which makes them very sort of acceptable to the reader, in the sense that you like the villains, you also like the protagonists and the heroes of the novel. Now, this is something which is, being a mythology writer myself, I found this very much in the epics. In our epics, the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, you always have this. So I wanted to ask you, is your storytelling style influenced by the epics, and have you then created what is the Indian thriller?
Well, I would say it's not only the epics. I mean, you know, the reason I started writing, of course, at a much later age, is because my grandfather, the consummate liar that I was talking about, Nanaji had a huge library in Kanpur, which is where he used to live. And he had 8,000-10,000 books. And every week he would lovingly send me one book, handpicked, to read. And during his lifetime, he gave me about 300 to 400 books. And those included, for example, the epics. Like, for example, I remember reading Raja Gopalchari's Mahabharata retold, probably in my teens. But there was also a ton of philosophy in those books. There was also a ton of science in those books. And of course, politics. I mean, I don't know how I succeeded in reading War and Peace, probably when I was in my late teens. And Autobiography of a Yogi was probably my first introduction to something which was beyond the ordinary realm of what we consider to be the ordinary world. So there was a ton of that stuff going on. And the books that he sent me were exceptionally varied. I mean, the man had a naughty side to him also. So in later years, he also sent me Lady Chatterley's Lover. He also sent me Fanny Hill. And he said, no, you must read it. What's the big deal? Read it. And so in that sense, he was very, very open-minded about the sort of books that he shared with me. The other advantage was that my mother was always a paperback reader. She loved the latest fast-paced fiction. So whether it was the latest Jeffrey Archer or Sidney Sheldon or Arthur Haley or Frederick Forsyth, she would have it. And once she was done reading it, she would pass it on to me. Now, what was happening actually, which I didn't know at that time, it was brain mapping that was going on.
Yes.
Almost a bit of re-engineering of my brain. But there was content that was coming to me from Nanaji, whether it was spiritual, philosophical, religious, cultural, political. And on the other hand, the style that I was absorbing from the books that my mother was giving me. So I love the fast-paced thriller as a format. It's, you know, I mean, it was the great Alfred Hitchcock who said that the length of a movie is related to the endurance of the human bladder. Because there's only so much time that you can spend at a movie before you need to get up. So when I sit down to write a book, I think that there is a group of 10 people around me and I'm telling them a story. And while I'm telling them the story, there are three or four people who desperately need to get up and use the restroom, but they don't because the story is so interesting. Now, if you can achieve that, then in that case, I think you have the makings of a very, very good book because then the pages will turn themselves. And I think bringing in the combination of those two streams, the fact that you have the you have a depth in terms of philosophy, in terms of religion, in terms of history, and at the same time, you are presenting it in the format of almost, you could say, a McDonald's burger, then that is what is interesting.
So basically what you're saying is that it's the idea of the thali.
Absolutely.
Being presented
in... It's a gourmet burger.
Yeah, oh yeah, that's a good way to put it. Now, I'll come to your specific novels.
Sure.
Yeah. So let's start with Chanakya's Chant. You've developed the character of the Brahmin Vishnu Gupt from the beginning, about whom nothing is really known, and you at the end of the book, in the middle of the book rather, you see him as Chanakya, the kingmaker.
Yes.
So what is it that fascinated you about this persona, about whom very little is actually known?
You know, I love characters which are grey, where it's difficult to pin them down that they are good or bad. And sort of Chanakya fits into that category beautifully. The wonderful thing is that on the one hand, we have this seminal work, which is Arthashastra, which was written supposedly by Kautilya 2300 years ago. And on the other hand, there is very little which has been written about Chanakya. So we have a lot written by Chanakya, but very little written about Chanakya. The only work that we consider to be the basis of our history is a Sanskrit play known as the Mudra Rakshas. And Mudra Rakshas was written by a poet called Vishakhadatta sometime almost about 600-700 years after Kautilya had passed on. Now, it's very possible that Vishnugupt was an Ashwin Sanghi of his time, liberally taking fact and fiction and mixing them together. So, in other words, what we now consider as de facto history may not be de facto history. Because it was a play. It was a Sanskrit play. So it had to obviously hold the audience's attention. But what I do find about Kautilya from the Arthashastra is that this was a man who obviously considered that the ends were more important than the means. But more importantly, there was a tremendous streak of patriotism in whatever he did.
Hmm.
And no matter how ghastly it was.
Hmm.
Like, for example, I talk about... if you read the Arthashastra, the last chapter of the Arthashastra contains cocktail recipes.
Hmm.
And he talks about how alcohol can be brewed in various ways.
Are you serious? Now, cocktail recipes?
Yes.
Yeah.
And Chanakya is not concerned about drinking.
Hmm.
What he's concerned about is how does he manage the drinking taverns, which are a source of revenue for the kingdom. So he specifies, and then he also specifies to the intelligence operatives, because every drinking tavern also has a couple of intelligence guys, because when you are inebriated, you are more likely to talk. So he uses it as an intelligence gathering tool.
Yeah.
Now, that's the stuff about Kautilya, which fascinates me. That, I mean, it's almost like a... It's like a manual on governance written 2,300 years ago. It could very well be a McKinsey report of its time.
Perfect. Now, now the modern day politician in the Chanakya's chant, Ganga Sagar Mishra. Where did the inspiration for this character come from?
A lot of people ask me that. Frankly, I don't know. The physical persona is based actually on a teacher who used to come to our home. We used to call him Masterji. And he used to wear a crisp dhoti and a kurta, and he used to carry a chata. And when he used to get angry, then he would hit you with the chata. If you weren't learning your multiplication tables properly, then he would hit you with the chata. So that particular persona is what I wanted to translate into Ganga Sagar Mishra. But of course, the political part of it comes from a lot of people. It comes from Narasimha Rao. It comes from Atal Bihari Vajpayee. It comes from Mayawati. There are tons and tons of people who have eventually sort of made their way into that final character.
Yeah, he's the quintessential modern, modern day Indian politician.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
And I wanted to bring across, I mean, who was it who said that what the definition of politics, I mean, split it up into two words, poly and tics. Poly as in many, and tics meaning blood-sucking creatures. I wanted to bring that across through Chanakya's chant. That everyone is a bloodsucker at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Some of them do it more elegantly and some of them do it more crudely.
Yeah. But Chanakya wasn't.
Well, Chanakya also, I mean, you think about the fact that he had an entire team of women who were known as Vishkanyas. And what was a Vishkanya? A Vishkanya was someone who had been born astrologically on a date which indicated widowhood. And this was a woman who was then fed graduated doses of poison throughout her life so that she became utterly toxic, capable of handling poison herself, but anyone who came into contact with her immediately died. So that was a Vishkanya. There was a scientific basis to a Vishkanya. Now you can imagine this was the thought of this man, that he used them as assassins. So they were the proverbial honey trap, as it were. So, I mean... I don't think that Chanakya was any less of a blood-sucking creature in that sense.
Yeah, cold-blooded. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. Now, you said something about the what-if question. We've just got time for maybe one quick question.
Sure.
So, Keepers of the Kal Chakra, this is your latest novel. I'm going to just leave this to you to answer. What is the what-if question that underlies this novel?
Well, I mean, what fascinated me was the... possibility. I mean, we in physics we have a concept which is known as quantum entanglement. And what quantum entanglement tells you is that if you were to take a very basic particle, what a quantum particle, and place one theoretically in New York and the other one in New Delhi, if those two particles are quantumly entangled, they will behave exactly the same way even though thousands of miles are separating them. So, in other words, you would find that the spin, the velocity of the spin would be identical of those two particles. So the thought that came into my mind was that what if you didn't only have quantum entanglement, but you also had it in the physical world? So supposing you could have quantumly entangled planets or quantumly entangled universes or quantumly entangled human beings, what would happen? And the idea came to me actually from a very terrible nightmare. That nightmare was so real that I got up in the morning feeling that I had almost lived it. And so I began to wonder to myself that is it possible that when I sleep and I go into my dream state, what I call my dream state, could that be my real life? And is it possible that what I'm living right now is actually my dream state? Is it possible that I'm living two lives?
It's a very philosophical nightmare.
Oh, absolutely.
No?
Absolutely. It was. Probably brought on by an extended bout of inebriation the previous night. But nevertheless, it brought home that very big question that is what we consider real, real?
Yeah.
That was it.
Yeah. I would love to go on, but I think we are running short of time now. So we have 15 minutes for questions. So please raise your hands for any questions out there. I'm sure you must be having lots of things to ask Ashwin.
Sure. Is someone handing out mics? Yeah, lovely.
Good morning, sir.
Morning.
I just want to know, how do you do your research? You seem to know a lot. You are a walking library, you are a walking Google, walking Wikipedia, everything. How do you do your research and store it in your memory?
Sure. Well, first time I've been called that I'm a walking Google. And sometimes Google ends up showing you search results that you don't want. So remember that. Having said that, I think for me the starting point is probably figuring out an idea which is going to be the kernel of a story. And that inspiration usually comes from different places. With Chanakya's chant, it was because of the elections, 2009 elections. And I was feeling that the entire election was very messy. And I thought, has politics always been so messy? And so the only way to answer that question was going back 2,300 years into the times of the Arthashastra. Or for example, the Krishna key was brought on by someone asking me about the Kalki Avatar. And the next morning, I ended up calling for an English translation of the Kalki Puran and read it from beginning to end and realized that that was a fascinating story. So it starts with that idea. Once you have that idea, then you start developing a research plan around it. So for example, Krishna key was a research plan of travel. Whether it was to Dwarka, whether it was to Somnath, and so on and so forth. With Chanakya's chant, it was a multiple reading of the Arthashastra. And then, of course, a reading of the Mudra Rakshas. Sialkot Saga, I wanted to recreate the atmosphere of 1950s and 60s Calcutta and Bombay. So I actually ended up interviewing a lot of people. And of course, then there is the research that you need to do in terms of making your story sound real. So for example, my crime thrillers that I write with James Patterson, never in my life have I visited a morgue, but I actually did because I wanted to describe what happens inside an Indian morgue. How are the bodies kept and what is the stench and what is the smell of that entire experience? I remember when I was writing another novel, I ended up interviewing a police officer who showed me a black colored pipe, and it was a rubber pipe. And I asked him, I said, what is this? He said, this is what is known as a Samaj Sudharak. I said, what is a Samaj Sudharak? He said, well, with this, when we put you into the lockup, we can beat you and beat you in a way whereby no marks will be left on your body. So those are the little interesting nuggets which make a story come alive. So you do need to spend that time, whether it's 6 months, 9 months, or a year, you do need to spend that time investing in that research. And then I do a ton of reading at the time when I'm writing a book. So I will all perpetually be emailing myself. I have a separate Gmail account, which is my idea bank, and that no one else emails me because it's a very complicated email ID. So I only email myself. Over the years, I've emailed myself over 15,000 times. So with tons and tons of stuff. So when I'm sitting down to write a book, all I need to do is actually go back to my research material, which is all there.
Yeah, the mic, please. I think there's someone, hands going up.
Hello, sir. Hello,
Hi.
Ma'am. You mentioned about history having different perspective from different people. You mentioned about 1857, the first revolt of independence.
Yes.
I remember my grandparents saying the Rama in a different way.
Yes.
Like people in the north might be knowing Ram, Sita, Lakshman as the heroes of the Ramayana. But I know the story where Ravan is considered to be hero. He is equally as good as Ram.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but you said you believe more in mythology than that of history.
Yes.
So if even mythology has many different faces with respect to perspectives of people, then how
of
do you consider that to be much better than history?
Okay. Well, because the at least with mythology, we know that they are different perspectives. The problem with history is that we present one particular perspective and we treat that as fact. So in that sense, mythology is more truthful because we say, hey, listen, this is one version. I mean, one of the very interesting things that happened to me when I was attending a student seminar in Kolkata was ending up visiting a temple. And when I reached into the temple, I realized that the person that was being worshipped, the deity that was being worshipped, was actually Amitabh Bachchan. I didn't realize that it was an Amitabh temple that I had gone into. And I came outside from the temple, and there was this young man who was selling all the stuff which is needed for a puja. And amongst those was a little prayer booklet known as the Amitabh Chalisa. And I thought to myself at that moment, I said, listen, isn't it possible that at this point of time, standing at the crossing, the road crossing, a car comes at a high speed, knocks me down, I die on the spot, I'm reborn 1,000 years later, and the cult of Amitabh worship has really caught on, and now there isn't one temple but 1 lakh temples or 10 lakh temples, right? And that's precisely what has happened with a lot of our mythological figures or our theological figures, that probably they are rooted in some kernel of history, but then everyone has presented their own version of events around that. And we've, of course, in India, our food tends to be spicy. We love putting tadka. We love putting spice on everything. And that's what we did with our stories also. For the longest time, we never had a written record of many of these stories. Even the Ved or the Rig Ved was transmitted orally for many, many years. So it's like a game of Chinese whispers. What goes in at one end of the circle isn't what comes out at the other end of the circle. But that doesn't imply that it didn't start out with a kernel of truth. And that's really what we are searching for. That what is that kernel of truth? What I essentially end up doing is I take two words, myth and history, and consider that you've taken these two words, and since we've just talked about quantum physics, we've put them into a particle collider. And we've brought these two words crashing towards one another at a phenomenal speed so that they fuse. And myth and history come together, and then they answer that one very, very interesting question, which is a mystery, because myth and history is equal to mystery. And that's precisely what you need to do.
Yeah, that was a very good answer.
Hello, sir. You said you have to be a... You said you have to be a consummate liar to be a fiction writer. So what liberty or degree of freedom that a writer should or can take when writing mythological fiction,
sure,
especially so with historical fiction, considering
sure
the current landscape in India where you're bound to hurt some part of the society with your
liberties? Oh yeah, absolutely. I remember when I had just written the Rosabal line, I started receiving an email every day from someone who would always quote to me a passage from the Bible. And eventually I had to put it into my spam folder because it used to land up every day. And one fine day after about like maybe a couple of months, I asked, why do you do this? Why do you send me this passage? He said, because you've written utter blasphemy and your soul is damned. So I'm trying to bring you some possible blessings in order to help you save your soul from damnation. So that is the nature of what we do. But what I like to ask people who say, what liberties can you take? Well, the fact that we have 300 versions of the Ramayana tells us that it was always a pattern for us to be taking liberties with those events. Each one presented it in a certain way. and we didn't have a problem with that. So why should we have a problem with it now? Whether it is an Anand Neelkanthan or an Amish Tripathi or a Devdutt Patnaik or an Ashwin Sanghi, all of us are pretty much actually carrying on a very, very generous tradition, a liberal tradition of this country, which is presenting one more version. But yes, having said that, I do think you owe it to your readers to do your research, and then you can in turn say that, listen, this is one version. There could be others. If you'll look at most of my books, you will find that at the end of the book, there will be 100 or 150 sources from where I've actually taken the material. Sometimes I will also present to you sources of material which are at odds with my story, which are at odds with the position that I've taken. Because I don't treat the book as a gospel truth, but I treat it as just an exploration. And if the story really interests you, I would hope that you would actually research into those bits more and more. The way I like to think of it is that the way you do a construction of a building, you put up the columns and the beams, and once the columns and the beams are up, then you can add in the plaster of Paris and the cement and the bricks, all of that. So the columns and the beams are your research. That is not really changeable. That is the structure. And then you have the liberty to fill the gaps. Like, why is Chanakya an interesting story? Because very little is written about him. So I can take liberties with that story. So the older the story and the less the number of sources for that story, that is what enables us liars to do our job.
Somebody in the first row.
We'll take that question and then first row, please. All yes.
Right. So as I stand up now, I have some butterflies in my stomach.
Okay,
so I guess that's natural.
I hope it's not related to something you ate.
No, not something related to what I ate. What I'm trying to say is, when you start, there's always something that's holding you back. So did you experience something of the sort when you began writing? Because your strong point, from what I gained from this interview and from your books as well, seems to be your research. But is there something that you weren't good at? How did you overcome that?
Sure. I'm still a lousy writer. I'm not in any way denigrating myself, but I'm a lousy writer. I'm a half acceptable rewriter. So I, by the time it goes into a second, third, fourth rewrite, and by the time then my poor haggard editor, who's sort of like, you know, I mean, she has to do a ton of work in order to make it presentable. In school, I was a lousy essay writer. My English professor, I still remember his name was Elisha. He used to say, Sanghi, you scatter commas and periods all over the page as if you are sprinkling salt and pepper. Do you even know what a comma and full stop, what it's supposed to do? And here I was suddenly writing, you know, 100,000 words. But you know what? You can get a dime a dozen great editors. I hope Shiny is not here. You can get a dime a dozen great editors. The problem is you can't get storytellers. And that's what you really need to be doing, because they can't replicate your story or they can't tell your story. Otherwise, they would have been storytellers and you would have been an editor. So this is the most important thing to remember. And I think in your life, there will always be one moment where you realize that you have a story, and the story has, you know, people think that you need to go out finding a story. You don't go out finding a story. A story finds you. For me, it was the visit to Srinagar, where I went to this old tomb. That tomb has sat there from 124 AD. And there is a Muslim saint buried there. Nasiruddin is his name, from the 13th century, with the head pointing towards Mecca. And what is fascinating is that there is a second body underneath Nasiruddin, which goes back to the origin of the tomb. And that is not an Islamic burial, obviously, because it's 500 years before Islam. And that burial is an east-west burial, which is the ancient Jewish custom. Outside the tomb is a metallic plate showing a pair of human feet with cross marks where the nails for a crucifixion would have happened, you know, gone in. And I realized that I was obsessed by that story. And suddenly the story had found me. And then after that, there was no going back. So I think you just need to wait for that moment to come. I've written about this in my book, 13 Steps to Bloody Good Luck. That, you know, there's that 1% bloody good luck which comes in your life. And but you can't time it. The time happens just then.
Hi, Ashwin. Quick question. How do you select the titles for your books? Because is there a pattern that I see? Sialkot Saga, Chanakya's Chant,
of course
the
there
Keepers
is.
Of the Kal Chakra. Is there some numerology or something to do
There's
with
There's no lettering? Numerology involved. But unlike a lot of authors who believe that their job is simply to write a good story, my view has always been that if you're going to invest 2 years in writing a story, then you should be investing another 6 months to a year in marketing it. And so in that sense, I tend to involve myself a lot more, whether it's on things like cover design. People say, oh, you know, I mean, ultimately, you know, a book cover is irrelevant. It's the story within. No, the book cover is what decides whether someone will pick up the book or not. They did a study in the US and they found that the average browser in a bookshop spends 8 seconds on the front cover and 13 seconds on the back cover. And within that period of time, he decides whether he's taking the book to the cash counter or not. So I always look for titles which will do the job of selling the book. And so the catchier the title, the better it is. So it is that old Banya tendency which tends to show up even as a writer. And of course, the other part of it is that there is the... during my early days as a writer, there was a salesman at my publishing company, Westland. He gave me the golden rule. He said, "Saab, ek cheez yaad rakhiye, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai." So for me, the visibility factor of the cover is exceptionally important. And within a year, year and a half of the Rosabal line coming out, I walked into a bookstore to find my book. And I found only 3 copies in a dusty bookshelf somewhere in the corner. I picked those books up, I brought them and I put them on the bestseller rack. And I said, well, you know, now my book is a book bestseller. And so ultimately, you know, you need to be a little shameless about marketing. I've always maintained to a lot of young writers who talk to me, they say, what is the big quality for marketing your book? I said, become Besharam. Once you're Besharam, then your books will sell.
There's no time for any more questions. We've had some forewarnings, so we'll have to close this session. And thank you for being such an interactive audience. I think that is because Ashwin is such a wonderful storyteller.
Thank you, Madhavi, and thank you, guys. You've been wonderful. Thank you.